it's abomination in God's eyes, it's abomination.
That's right.
So we were there for that, and I believe we didn't see Matt there. We saw him at the gay pride parade in San Francisco. We were there for the homos coming out, and we get to get married, and it was just pandemonium. But before that happened, you know, we had a big crowd out in front of the city hall, and it's just people everywhere, and all the media from all over the world is there. There was this big, tall guy, about 6'8", and just top to bottom in leather. Skinny as a rail. He's walking around with a guitar singing, Jesus loves me, or whatever he was. I don't even know what he was singing. But he was walking around singing songs about how God honors and blesses this homo union. And the whole thing is of the Lord. You know, how they pervert it. So he's standing there singing, and Kevin preached to him directly. He came right in Kevin's face, and he preached at him and rebuked him. And I think at one point I looked at him like from a distance, like about from here to Petar, and I mouthed these words. I said, you had better repent before it's too late. And I looked him square in the eye, and he just kept on singing. And about 10 minutes later, he, boom, laying on the ground, dropped dead right in front of the whole circus. And you want to talk about it, everybody jumps back and clears the space, and he's laying on the ground, and the cops run over, and they're trying to resuscitate him, and I'm like, it's appointed unto man once to die, and then the judgment.
Hallelujah.
I started preaching that, and the cops came over about 2 minutes into that and said, look, can you guys just lay off for a few minutes, man, because we need to take care of this. So I did that. And I turned around, I'm talking to my wife, and I'm like, wow, I said, that guy just dropped dead right in front of us.
Yeah.
She's like, wow. I kind of thought he might have been faking.
Right.
At first. I thought he might have just been pulling a little stunt just to get a little bit of attention. You know what I mean? People do that. But there was a gentleman who broke through the line, and he flashed his badge, and he went in, and he was talking to somebody. And he wasn't dressed as a police officer, he was dressed undercover, but he looked like a reporter with a camera the whole nine yards, but he flashed his badge and went through. After the event, they carted him off, and then the homos did their thing, and we stood there and preached. After the event was done, we were across the street working our way towards the van, and I saw that same officer that flashed his badge. I said, what happened to that guy? He said, oh, he expired, and he got rebuked, he got warned, and he dropped dead right in front of him. Real quick, before I go into the message, I was in that little place that you call, whatever you call it, and they had something interesting there on the table. I picked it up, something about the economy. That's a big hot issue, and being that this nation no longer fears God, who's afraid of God anymore? Well, America's not afraid of God. Look how she lives. Look how the people live in our country.
Right.
Look how our government recklessly just puts us deeper and deeper into debt. This is, if you can see it, this is 1920, and the red is the national debt, and there's a little gray area up there called gross domestic product. You can't see that. But it goes 1920 all the way to 2010. We're not there yet. But here we are today, here's 1920, and the red is the national debt. And starting around 1980, we're at $2.3 trillion. And we are now just about at $9.6 trillion in debt. In debt to who, you say? Well, top five nations that the United States is indebted to. Japan, number one. China, number two. These guys own us. The UK, number three. The oil exporting nations, including Ecuador, Venezuela. You know who runs that country. Indonesia, Bahrain, Iran, Iraq, Kuwait, the list goes on. The oil exporting nations, they're number four. And guess, Bill Hamilton, guess who's number five?
Brazil.
30% of our debt goes out to those nations. They own us, man. They own this country. Anyway, just a little tidbit of information before I go into the message. So that you know where you stand as far as the economy goes. I'd like to start off and turn to Ecclesiastes chapter 12, begin the message today with a conclusion. I'll begin the message today with a conclusion. Ecclesiastes chapter 12, the entire chapter is, you guys probably know this. I'm preaching to the choir today, but I want to encourage you that when you walk in the fear of the Lord, the enemies of God will fear the Lord. If you walk in the fear of man, the enemies of God will not fear God. They'll be encouraged and they'll be strengthened in their wickedness, and you'll fail your mission as a Christian. Ecclesiastes chapter 12 says this, verse 13, let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. For God shall bring every work into judgment with every secret thing, whether it be good, whether it be evil. Praise the Lord for Pastor Stevenson. He made it clear. He made it concise today. The fear of the Lord and the fear of judgment and your lifestyle and the way you live should dictate and should reveal to you the terror of the Lord because of the judgment that you're going to face one day. Those who fear God, the Bible says, if you fear God, you will obey God. And if you obey God, you truly love God. Do you see the connection there? People say, oh, when you go out and preach, you're like, you're not supposed to fear God. You're supposed to love God. Well, they're absolutely and positively connected in the Bible that I read. What Bible are you reading?
Right.
Amen? Amen? If you fear God, you'll obey God. And if you obey God, Jesus said, you truly love me. Deuteronomy 6:4 says this. Well, 6:5 says this. What? What does it say? Deuteronomy 6:5. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, soul, mind, and strength. The theme throughout the children of Israel coming out of Egypt, coming and walking through the wilderness, obey. These are the commands, the testimonies, the statutes of the Lord. Obey me. Love me. Serve me. I pulled you out. Now serve me. Obey me. Fear me.
Yes.
Love me.
Yes.
It's all connected. Do you see the connection there? Jesus said, of course, John 14:5, if you love me, keep my commandments.
Amen.
Fearing God and loving God and obeying God are all intrinsically connected. It's connected, brother. It's there. If you don't fear God, or those who do not fear God, they don't obey God. Look at the nation we live in today. Look at the people that we deal with every day when we're preaching. Those of us who preach daily, maybe on the campus or on the streets or the events or wherever you do preach. Some of you are working full time still. I personally called out of my job. I just one day just read the paper and the Lord's like, time to quit your job, time to sell your house, time to give your stuff away and go preach. So I do that, and I know that other brothers have businesses, they preach, they still work. We talked about that earlier. But you go out and you preach and you see these people, there's no fear of God in them.
No.
Right.
There's no fear of God.
Right.
Who's afraid of God anymore? Well, those students ain't afraid of God.
No.
I mean, internally, we'll get to this point later. Inside in their mind, there is a fear that should be there. And they know they're supposed to fear God, but they don't. Right. Because their lifestyle testifies they don't fear God. The way they live, the way they act, the way they do everything they do every day of their life proves they don't fear God. Those who do not fear God, they don't obey God because they love themselves. John chapter 3. How many times have you heard a sinner quote John 3:16? And how many times did you just get under your skin and you just, man, why don't you just read a couple more verses down? Just read two more verses, three more verses, and you'll see how hypocritical you're being. What does it say in John 3, verse 19 and 20? This is the condemnation. Light has come into the world. Men love darkness rather than light because their deeds are evil. They won't come to the light lest their deeds be exposed,
right,
or reproved. That word reproved means to uncover, to expose. Ephesians 5, have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them or expose them. That's what that word means. That's why we go out there and preach and we deal with sin directly. We deal directly with the heart of the sinner.